Qiskiters. Today, we're going to be doing a GitHub 101 video, where we're going to cover the basics of what you need to know to get started with Git and GitHub. But to get us started, let's first clear up a few things around what actually is the difference between Git and GitHub. They're quite similar concepts, and people often get them confused. So Git is what's called a version control software. It's an open source software that you can install locally on your machine, on your laptop. It is a command line tool, so that basically means that you interact with it via your terminal. And essentially what it is a tool for managing different versions of edits to your files. So you can track over time who has changed which different lines within any given code file that you have. GitHub, on the other hand, is software as a service. It is hosted on the web. It has a graphical user interface that you might be familiar with. And it's essentially a platform that provides the space to store those versions and that history of code changes that is powered by Git. So you use Git to communicate with GitHub. Git is the technology that facilitates the tracking of the changes, and GitHub is the platform that keeps all of that information in one place for you. So let's get started with our friend Alice here. Alice has an online GitHub account, and in that GitHub account, she has one code repository called test repo, or otherwise known as a repo for short. This repository is essentially a folder that contains different code files for that project. And this is what it might look like on the GitHub platform itself. If you are like Alice and you like it in dark mode, it will be this dark color. It might look a bit different if you prefer light mode on your machine. And the version of the test repo code that we see here is the main branch. GitHub uses and Git uses branching as a metaphor to describe the life cycle of your code. So you can kind of imagine your code repo is a tree that is constantly growing and changing. Your main branch here is your default branch. It's the main trunk of that tree, and it tracks a timeline of your code. It's sometimes also referred to as the master branch. And we can track the history of code on this main branch by building up a history of commits. You can kind of think of commits like checkpoints. It keeps a log of the changes that you've made, so you can go back to them if you need to. So Alice can go to her commit tab on GitHub and see a historical log of all of the changes that she has made throughout the history of her code, ever since that very first commit that she made at the start. It's good practice to commit little and often. Each commit could be just a small change that touches only one file, or it could change a lot of files. But it's better to have those commits be small, maybe only touching one or two files, so that when you go back and look at your history, it's easier to see, where did something go wrong? Oh, you changed like at this commit, you changed these couple of files, and that's where a problem occurred. Each commit also has a long ID like this called a commit hash, but we don't really need to worry about that too much as users. What we really care about are the commit messages, which are human readable messages to kind of describe a bit about what was changed in that file. There's a lot of best practices around how to write good commit messages, and you can find information online on different ways of doing it. But basically, you want to summarize as succinctly as possible what key things that you did in that piece of work. So did something is a bad commit message. It doesn't really tell me what happened there, whereas something like added hello world file is much more explicit in telling me what change is actually in that commit. Next up, I want to talk about branching. So as we've spoken about already, the kind of history of a repo can be kind of represented kind of like a tree, where we have our main branch being the trunk of that tree. But just like any other real tree, we can have different branches of that, which represent different offshoots of our code. So for example, let's say our friend Alice wants to develop a new feature without breaking stuff that's kept in that main branch. Or maybe she's working with our friend Bob, and they don't want to interfere with each other in the work that they're doing. So what Alice can do is she can make branches for each feature that she is working on, and Bob could do the same. And this is generally good practice, and you want to keep your main branch for the final production-ready features of your code. And in the GitHub kind of platform, you can see in your branches tab a list of all the branches that you have and who was the last person to update them. Okay, so we've spoken a bit about what those repositories look like, what the code is as it currently exists on GitHub. But let's say, for example, Alice gets a new laptop, and she wants all of the code that she kept in her test repo in GitHub on her new laptop. All of that code that she was previously working with, that we were showing you, was kept in the GitHub platform in the cloud. And we call that her origin repository. But she has this new laptop. It doesn't have any of her code on it. So what she's going to need to do is she's going to need to clone that origin repo onto her local machine. And to do that, it's very simple. She can go into her GitHub platform. On the homepage, there's a big green button that says code, and that gives you instructions on how to clone your repo. Then what she can do is go to her terminal on her local machine, on her new laptop, and then she can type in git clone, and then the URL of the repo that she wants to get a copy of onto her machine. And what this does is it essentially makes a copy of all the code that was hosted on the GitHub platform and copies that to her local laptop. From there, now Alice has a local copy on her machine of her code that is now free for her to do local development work with in the way that she might normally do in her favorite code editor. And these two repos now, her origin, her remote origin repo and her local repo, will now evolve separately. It's also always a good idea when you're working locally, once you've cloned, just make sure that you've actually moved into the right project repo so you can start working in your terminal in the right place. Depending on how your terminal is set up, you might also get some helpful information here, like which branch you're working on. By default, when you clone your repo and then you move into that, Git will kind of show that you're working in the main branch. But for example, let's say that Alice wants to move between branches. She doesn't want to work on her main branch. She wants to move into a different branch. She can do that with the git checkout command. So she just types in git checkout and then the name of the branch she wants to move into. And then you can see now she's moved into that new branch. And any work she does will only make changes on that branch. It won't make changes in main where she was before. If she wants to create a new branch, she can do that by adding the dash B flag when she checks out. So if she does git checkout dash B new branch, this will create a new branch for her called new branch, branching off of main. And it will also kind of move her into that branch. So when she does any code work, she'll be working in that branch. And now that she's in her new branch, she wants to start working on things. And she can start making code changes and also building up more of that commit history that we mentioned earlier. So maybe she wants to add a hello world file. So to do that, she adds that file. But then to make that log actually appear in her commit history, she has to do git add and then the name of the file. And then, like we saw earlier, each commit has to have a commit message that goes with it. So what Alice will do is then she will type in git commit dash m, followed by whatever message that she wants to add to show what she's done. So in this example here, she's made changes in her hello world file. She has added hello world to a staging area, and then she's committed that by adding a message as well. And she can do this with multiple files. Maybe she made changes to different files, then she would add the files twice, git add hello world, and maybe git add hello new world, and again, write a commit. So you can have multiple files associated with a single commit. If you've added, if you changed a lot of files and you want to add all of them to your commit history, you can use git add and then a full stop, which will add everything that's kind of been changed into a single commit for you. And if at any point you want to check what changes you've made and what's actually, you know, in your staging area waiting to be committed, then you can type in git status and the terminal will print out a list of files for you of things that are changed and are ready to be added to a commit. Okay, so next up, now she has some new features that she's worked on in her local machine that's in her new branch. But now Alice wants to update her repository in her GitHub account with the changes that she's made locally. Because remember, at this point, her local repository and her origin repository in GitHub have been evolving separately. Everything she's been doing has been in her local new branch, but now she wants to update the repository in GitHub with those changes. So to do that, she needs to make a connection between her local repository and her origin repository. And to do that, she needs to add her origin as a remote for her machine. She can do this with git remote add origin, followed by the same URL that she used to clone the repo before. And then she can check that she's added it. And then once she's once she has that new branch ready to be added to the to her origin repository, she can then do git push origin new branch. And that will mean that now her remote origin repository is up to date with the latest work that she's done in that new branch. So once you've done that, a push is essentially taking code that you have locally, pushing it up to the cloud, up to GitHub. And once you've done that and you can go to the GitHub platform, you'll normally be able to see any new changes that you've made there. So you can see now that her new branch is here. And so her remote repository has been updated. And she can keep making commits, she can keep adding files, making changes, and do repeat pushes to keep that remote GitHub repository updated with what she's been doing locally. But the one thing that you want to be aware about and not do is always make sure that you, when you are making a push, you're pushing stuff from a branch on your local machine. Make sure that you're always going to be pushing it to the same branch in your origin repo in GitHub. So you never really want to be getting to a situation where you're in your new, like a feature branch thing here, and you should not then be doing git push origin main. Do not do this. Bad things will happen. Merge conflicts will occur. It's not a fun time. So make sure that you're always doing this. You're pushing from your feature branch to the same feature branch in your remote origin repository. Don't do this. So always double check before pushing anything. I've made this mistake many times myself, so I'm really trying to emphasize the point here. Okay, so let's say Alice has been working locally, but how does Alice keep her local machine, her local repository, updated with any changes that were made in the origin remote repository? For example, maybe she was working, she pushed some changes from a different laptop up to that GitHub profile. Maybe her friend Bob was also pushing stuff or adding new branches. And these, her local repository and her origin repository in GitHub have been evolving separately, as we said. So how does she get all of these updates here onto her local machine? Well, what she's going to need to do is she's going to need to fetch those changes from the origin by running git fetch origin. What fetch does is it will basically take any new changes that were in that GitHub repository and add them to her local repository. It does kind of a shallow kind of fetching. It downloads it to her repo, but it doesn't actually merge any changes into her branches that she's working on. So for example, say she's working on branch one, and there have been changes made to branch one in GitHub. She can fetch those to kind of show that those branches are appearing locally. But if she actually wants to merge any of those changes into her work, she'll then have to do git pull origin branch one as well. So it's always a good idea to fetch and then pull. If you have any new branches that were added in GitHub, you'll need to fetch them to make the branch show up locally so that you can then move into that branch and start working on it. So you're going to need to want to use those two commands in parallel. Okay, so, and let's say now that she wants to take any changes that she's made in main into her new branch, feature branch. She can, in this case, do git pull origin main. This is more acceptable than doing pushing to main. You should never push to main, but it's perfectly okay to pull from main. So long as you're aware of kind of what changes have been happening in main, you might want to keep your feature updated with anything that has changed in the main trunk of your repository. Sometimes though, when you do this, you will encounter a merge conflict. If you have not yet encountered merge conflicts in your GitHub journey, don't worry. I guarantee you will experience these at some point. But the key thing to remember is don't panic. It happens to the best of us, happens to me on pretty much a daily basis. But don't panic. There are plenty of, it seems scary at first, but there are plenty of different tips and tricks for getting around that. I really recommend this article on Medium. Go and check that out. We'll put the link in the description as well. And yes, if you ever get into a situation where you've got conflicts in your merges, don't worry. You can get out of it. Okay, and that completes our first GitHub 101 session today. Next time, we're going to talk more about using GitHub with other people. Thanks very much for listening.